We're going to carry on with the Word of God. We've been going through our fantastic journey in the Bible, in the book of Genesis. We're going to carry on that for a few minutes this morning. 2 weeks ago, we looked at the Tower of Babel as a transition story, going from the story of Noah to the story of Abraham, talking about the change in how God deals with things. We see the world before the flood, and we see the world after the flood. We see the world hasn't changed very much. The world was filled with evil before the flood, and God pronounces judgment on the world, and he destroys the world, but he gives a hope of salvation and how he saves Noah and his family, but the world doesn't really change. Things carry on, and we see that in the story of the Tower of Babel, where Nimrod and his followers and his descendants try to build this city and exalt themselves instead of God. And then we come to the story of Abraham in Genesis chapter 12. It's not always easy to put all the pieces of the Old Testament together, to see how they work together, to see the flow of events. We sometimes have this tendency to compartmentalize things and not see that flow. When we look at the Tower of Babel, I think we get this picture of, you get this group of people, they're building a tower, they start building this one day, on Tuesday, and then a week from Wednesday, God comes down to have a look and see what's going on, and doesn't like it, so he goes zap, changes everything, and the following Thursday, the moving vans are pulled in, and everybody's scattered, and the whole thing takes place in a couple of weeks. I think that's how we kind of see things in the Bible. But the reality is, a lot of events in the Bible don't give us a time frame, and things happen over quite a lengthy period of time. And that's probably what's going on as we transition from the story of the Tower of Babel into the story of Abraham. When we read in the first verse of Genesis chapter 12 that God calls Abraham to leave his country and to go to a new land, a land that it says that I will show you. It says that after what we would have read a few verses back, if we were to step back into the 11th chapter of Genesis, and we get starting in verse 27, it talks about the account of Terah. And this is the end of a genealogy of the descendants of Shem, who was one of the sons of Noah. And this is what we read. It says, Terah became the father of Abraham, Nahor, and Haran. And Haran became the father of Lot. While his father Terah was still alive, Haran died in Ur of the Chaldees in the land of his birth. Abraham and Nahor both married. The name of Abraham's wife was Sarah, and the name of Nahor's wife was Milcah, and she was the daughter of Haran, the father of both Milcah and Iscah. Now, Sarah was barren, she had no children. Now, Terah took his son Abram, his grandson Lot, son of Haran, and his daughter-in-law Sarah, the wife of his son Abram, and together they set out from Ur of the Chaldeans to go to Canaan. But when they came to Haran, they settled there. So we see here in those verses that Terah, the father of Abram, lived in Ur of the Chaldeans, which you may remember is where they had built or started building the Tower of Babel. It's in that same general area. And we see the people starting to scatter. But this is some time after God has stopped that building. Well, the reality is probably that people started, it wasn't that zap kind of thing where God, I'm talking to Jim 1 minute, and next minute I don't understand what he's saying. It's not like that. It's probably over time, perhaps over generations, that God has worked this out, and the people start to separate, and people start to drift apart. So we see generations have passed, and Terah decides, for whatever reason, that this is no longer the place for him and his family. And they leave. Now, his one son, Nahor, stays in Ur of the Chaldees, but Terah takes Abram and his grandson, and they leave. It's kind of understandable why they would do that. As people become different, as people, their languages start to grow apart, and language and culture are so closely associated, they start to build their own way of doing things, their own culture, and they become incompatible. We assume that Terah and his family you know, as descendants of Shem, are the preservers of God's truth. That they have maintained their connection with God and godliness as they understood it. They didn't know a whole lot about God. God had yet to reveal much about himself. But they were the preservers of God's truth in all probability. But these other people are starting to identify their own ways of doing things, and they start to create their own religious beliefs, and they drift away from the ways of God. And their own practices get very uncomfortable for those who are followers of God. This is a way that people do things. It's very, very common. We even see that elsewhere in the scriptures. We see that in the nation of Israel. If you remember the story in the Old Testament, you remember King Solomon. King Solomon presided as king over Israel, and then he dies, and he has a son. Well, his son is not quite as wise as his father, and because he makes some pretty bad decisions, most of the nation decides we don't want him as king anymore, and they choose their own king, Jeroboam, and we end up with a divided kingdom, the southern kingdom of Israel and the northern kingdom. And what's one of the first things that King Jeroboam does as king of this separate nation? He starts to institute idol worship because he wants them to develop their own distinct identity separate from those southerners. And this is probably the kind of thing that happened in Ur of the Chaldeans. And Terah's getting really uncomfortable about this, and he can't live with the paganism that's going on and the idolatry. And somewhere in there, somehow, and we don't know how, God calls Abram and says, I want you to leave. It's time for you to get out of here. And Terah has a mind that they're going to go to this land of Canaan, out in the west, which is interesting because if you remember, we talked a couple of weeks ago, those of you who were here, how the Bible in Genesis had used the symbolism of moving east as being moving away from the blessings of God. We'd seen that when Adam and Eve left the Garden of Eden. We'd seen that when Nimrod was leaving to build the Tower of Babel. We've seen in other places, moving east was moving away from the blessings of God. Well, now God is calling Terah and Abram, and they're moving west, and they're moving to the promised land, what eventually becomes the promised land, the land of Canaan, the land of God's blessing. Now, Terah, for whatever reason, they get partway along the journey. You know, the journey is they have to sort of go up the Euphrates River, around the desert, and they come sweep up north, and then they come back down south along the coast into what we know as, you know, Israel and Lebanon and those areas now. They get up in the very high north, and they come to this land, this town called Haran. I don't know if it's because it sounded like the name of his dead son or what the reason was, but for some reason, Terah decides he's going to stay there. And they stay there for some period of time, and eventually Terah dies, and we step into chapter 12, where it talks about God's calling of Abram. Now, it's possible that this happened after Terah died, but it's probable that it actually happened earlier, while they were still living in Ur of the Chaldeans. I want us to look for a few minutes at this calling of Abram. Because this is one of the most significant events in all the history of Israel, therefore one of all the history of the world, and certainly the history of God's people, flowing right down to you and to me. That God is starting a really big, great, and important thing here. We need to understand some things about this call. If we're going to understand how God is working, because remember I said that God's changing how he deals with things. He's going from judging the world from the flood to saving the world. The world hasn't changed after the judgment of the flood. But God's way of dealing with things has changed. Because now he's not going to destroy the world. He's going to unleash a plan to save the world. Now, God takes a long time to do things. We think it's a long time. To God, it doesn't take a long time. For us, it's a long, long time. And we're talking from the time of Abraham to today, we're talking 4,000 years. We're talking 4,000 years ago this happened. But God's unfolding plan does take a long time. But God's plan does unfold. So let's have a look here. We're going to read the first 9 verses. And then I'm just going to have a quick look at a few things about this talk. Genesis chapter 12. The Lord had said to Abram, "Leave your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you." So Abram left, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he set out from Haran. He took his wife Sarah, his nephew Lot, all the possessions they had accumulated, and the people they had acquired in Haran, and they set out for the land of Canaan, and they arrived there. Abram traveled through the land as far as the site of the great tree of Moreh at Shechem. At that time the Canaanites were in the land. The Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring I will give this land." So he built an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there he went on towards the hills east of Bethel and pitched his tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. There he built an altar to the Lord and called on the name of the Lord. And then Abram set out and continued toward the Negev. So this is the wanderer, Abram, finally arriving into this land, called by God, receiving promises of God. This is going to be the only time we're going to look at Abram. Abram is such a key figure. And I want us to look at this calling. And I want us to look right now very quickly at 5 things about God's call of Abram. And then we're going to look at 3 things about Abram's response. It sounds like a lot, but we're going to do it pretty quickly. First thing I understand about God's calling of Abram is that Abram did not earn God's call. He didn't earn it. He didn't get called because he was special. God chose him, and he chose him for his own reasons. Abram wasn't necessarily any more righteous. He wasn't necessarily some kind of spiritual giant. He wasn't some guy that we would look up to and say, "I can't be like Abram." Abram was an ordinary guy. He was a very ordinary man. He was like you and me. It's just how we would have been 4,000 years ago. God doesn't call the special. God makes people special. When God calls you and you obey, he will make you somebody special. You don't have to earn it. How many people think, "I am not worthy of doing something for God. I'm not good enough"? That's not God's way. You are God's treasure, no matter who you are. And God chooses you not because of your worthiness, but because he knows how you fit into his plan. Abram didn't earn his call. You don't earn his call. But he can call you nonetheless. And he will use you, just as he used Abram. The only merit, if you like, that Abram had was the fact that he had a receptivity to God's call. He was willing to do what God called him to do. We know sometimes that there are those who resist God's call. You read through the Bible, people resisting God's call, and it doesn't always turn out very well, does it? Think of Jonah. You know the story of Jonah? God calls him, sends him to preach in Nineveh, nation of their great enemies. Jonah says, "No, I'm not doing that." God tells him to go east, so Jonah goes west. He gets a first-class ticket in the belly of a whale. I don't think I want that. I don't know about you. So God, Abram didn't earn the call. God's choice is a sovereign choice. But interestingly, you notice that in verse 1, how God put that call on. God didn't tell him where he was going. He says, "I want you to go to a land that I will show you." You ever want God to tell you exactly what you're doing? Don't you wish God could send you an email? Say, "Do this." But God doesn't work that way. It's amazing. God doesn't work that way. And we've told the story when we were coming here from Kingston. when Donna and I have resigned our jobs, we're resigning our jobs with the federal government taking up our appointment, and we put the for sale sign in front of the house. Our neighbors, of course, quite surprised, so they all, the good neighbors always do, run right over and say, "You're moving, where are you going?" "I don't know." We didn't know where we were going. We knew we were going to be reaccepted as officers, but we had no idea where we were going. You know, "Where are you going?" "I don't know." "What are you going to be doing?" "I don't know." "Why are you selling your house?" Because God told me. Because God had called us to something new. You're crazy. But you know, because God called us. And when you obey God's call, you go. And you may not know where you're going when you start out. But God calls, and He doesn't always give us the full plan. He tells us what we need to know when we need to know it. Not when we want to know it. The third thing is that God calls him and tells him to leave his old life behind. Do you see how the call was? He says, Abram says to, the Lord said to Abram, "Leave your country, it's time to move. Leave your people, you're going to a whole different group of people. Leave your father's household. Leave your family. Leave the people who are closest to you." And in this day and age, particularly in that day and age, family was so close. They lived together their whole lives. You know, it's not like today, like my daughter lives in Saskatchewan. No, they stayed together as much as they possibly could because they needed each other. They were the strength that they had for each other. He says, no, leave it all behind. That's one of the greatest challenges that we have when God calls us, is to leave it all behind. You see, God doesn't call us to add a new life on top of an old life. When He calls us to leave behind our old life. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, Apostle Paul writes that, you know, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. He's not a renovated creation. He's not a redecorated creation. He's not a modified creation. He's a new creation. Because the old has gone. It's not been packed up in a box and put into the attic for future use. It's been sent to the thrift store. It's gone. And the new has come. How many of us want to keep our old life and tack it on a little religious belief on top of that? You know, I like my old life. I'll happily put God in there somewhere. How many of us want to do that? Remember a while ago when we were driving up, and you know, we'd be driving from home or back from home, and there's a church along the way, and on the sign outside the church, it would say something. It said something about, "See how God's plan fits into your plan." It said something like that. And every time I drove by that, I would say something to Donna. Donna would say, "Yeah, I know, you told me, you said that before." Just, you know, that sign is so wrong. Because God's plan doesn't fit into our plan. God's plan replaces our plan. Are we willing to let go of all things and live a new life according to God's call? Fourth thing about God's call, notice this. God promises Abram the very thing that Nimrod and his family, his friends, his followers, his descendants, the very things that they were looking for when they were building the Tower of Babel. So look what he says. Did you see this? "I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing." Let's jump back a chapter to the story of the Tower of Babel, just as a reminder. Verse 4, chapter 11, verse 4. "Then they said, 'Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens, so that we can make a name for ourselves. And not be scattered over the whole face of the earth.'" what they were looking for to do for themselves and failed miserably, God is now saying to Abraham, that's what I'm going to do for you. That's what I'm going to do. You see, people, what we want in our lives, we all want good things, don't we? You don't have to be a Christian to want good things. You don't have to be a Christian to want the very things that God wants to give you in your life. It's a question of how we go about it. When we try to do all the things in our own strength, in our own ways, in our own wisdom, we're likely to fail. But God wants to give those good things to us. Seek first the kingdom of God, Jesus said, and all these things will be given to you as well. But it comes from seeking God. Do you remember the story of the temptation of Jesus, where Satan comes and tempts him in the wilderness? You know, Satan didn't come to him and tempt him with totally ridiculous things. You know, outrageous things, things that were wrong. Satan came and tempted him with the very things that Jesus wanted. Go back and look at it. I won't spend too much time on it. He tempted him with good things. The problem was not the what, but the how. Seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be given to you as well. And the fifth thing about God's calling to Abram is that God promised to bless Abram, but the blessings are intended to be blessings to others. God doesn't promise us blessings for ourselves. He gives to us that we can give to others. You know that? We have received so that we can give. We are blessed so that we can be a blessing. We are comforted so that we can comfort others. We are rich so that we can give to the poor, etc., etc., etc. God's blessings are not given for our own sake, but for the sake of others. That's why Jesus tells us, you know, that we are servants. Whoever wants to be the greatest in God's kingdom will be what? A servant of all. But he also promises that whoever, you know, he says, whoever wants to be first will be last. Whoever is last, he says, will be first. He will exalt those who humble themselves. So God has called us to be a blessing to others, not hoard all the things that he's given to us. The blessings of God are a responsibility. They're not a perk. Now, God has called Abram with these five things, these five characteristics. Now, what about Abram? What kind of response does he have? What can we learn about the response? Because God calls us the same way. First thing to notice, of course, the most obvious thing probably of all things is that Abram obeyed. You know, God doesn't, when God issues a calling, when God calls us to something, it's not an invitation that we can accept or reject, and we look at our schedule and say, yeah, no, I'm sorry, it's a conflict, I can't make it. When God calls us, we drop everything. Everything else has to go, and we have to obey. See, it's not optional. Or we can be disobedient, but it really isn't optional. We cannot escape the consequences of disobedience. Already talked about Jonah. Jonah tried to resist. Well, we saw what happened. Apostle Paul. I mean, this is the guy who preached the gospel, who gave up a great life, and had so much discomfort, had so much trouble, had so much suffering, had so many difficulties, so much opposition, so many people wanted to kill him just because he's trying to tell people about the love of Jesus. Makes sense. I'm telling you someone loves you, you're going to kill me. Makes a lot of sense. But this is what he did. Imagine how much he wanted to quit. Imagine how much he wanted to quit. But he writes to the Corinthian church and he says this, if I preach the gospel, that gives me no ground for boasting. For a necessity, he says, is laid on me. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. I'd like to shut up and go live in comfort. But I can't. I have to keep doing it. There's no option. God's calling to you is not optional. What is God calling you to do specifically? I can't tell you. I can't stand here and say, you know, this is yours, this is yours, this is yours. I mean, there are things we all share in common. Call to righteousness, the call to worship, call to holiness, call to service. How that's going to look will all be different for every one of us. But it's not optional. God's calling demands obedience. And Abram was obedient. The second thing is that Abram set out even though he didn't know where he was going. Sometimes we sit and want to wait for God to give us all the details. How can I go and do something if I don't know what God wants me to do? God, when you tell me, I'll do it. But like we already said, God's not sending the email. There is no letter coming into the mail with a detailed plan that says, royally you have to go here on this day at this time. God reveals what he needs to reveal when he needs to reveal it. Faith means action. Obedience means getting up and going. Sometimes we don't know where we're going, but it involves getting up and going, even if we don't know where. God will show us at the right time. And you want to know something? This is the thing that excites me sometimes about being a Christian, an obedient Christian. Because did you know that being a Christian is an adventure? Have you ever thought about about the fact that being a Christian is an adventure? It really is. If we want to experience the adventure, it means we have to set out when we don't know where we're going. And we'll see where we get there. And we never know what's going to happen along the way. Of course, sometimes if we knew what was going to happen, we'd say, no, I'm going to stay here, thank you. I don't like the looks of that. But God won't take us places we can't handle. Because we don't have to handle it, he does. Isn't that great? Take the adventure. Step out. See what will happen. You never know. But there's one downside in Abram's response. Again, to show that Abram's not perfect. He's not the great spiritual giant. He's just like you and me. You see, Abram's obedience was not perfect. It was not complete. He did mess up in his response. When he looked at him, what did God say? He called him, leave your country, leave your people, leave your father's household, and go to the land I will show you. But then what do we find? Just drop down to verse 4. So Abram left. Good, he was obedient. And Lot went with him. Lot went with him. Hold it! What happened to leaving your family behind? Lot.